ओम श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ओम सदाशिवसमारम्भां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्परां श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वन्दे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहायदक्षिणामूर्तये नमः गुकारस्वन्धकारो वै ऋकारस्तन्निवर्तकः अन्धकारनिरोधित्वात् गुरुरित्यभिधीयते ॐ सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहिः ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ ब्रह्मविदा आप्नोति परं तदेषाभ्युक्ता सत्यं ज्ञानमनन्तं ब्रह्म यो वेदनिहितं गुहायां परमे व्योमन् सोऽश्नुते सर्वान् कामान् सह ब्रह्मणा विपश्चितेति ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः सैषानन्दस्य मीमांसा भवति युवा स्यात् साधु युवाध्यायकः आशिष्टो दृढिष्टो बलिष्ठः तस्येयं पृथिवी सर्वा वित्तस्य पूर्णा स्यात् स एको मानुष आनन्दः ते ये सतं मानुषा आनन्दाः ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः युवा प्रथमवयाः साधु युवा इति साधुश्चासौ युवा च इति यूनः विशेषणं युवापि असाधुर्भवति साधुः अपि अयुवा अतः विशेषणं युवा स्यात् साधु युवा इति सो दिस् आनन्दमीमांसा has started. How do you understand Ananda in this world and the Ananda of a Jnani, of a Brahmavid? So what is this Ananda? Happiness, the pleasedness, and how does it increase? It is a Mimamsa. There is a Vichara that is done. Okay, just to understand what this happiness is and how does it change with the change of upadhi. That is the Ananda Mimamsa. So towards that Ananda Mimamsa, the first thing that needs to be done is to define the unit of human happiness. So what is the best possible happiness a human can get? So it is done, the unit is defined based on the common knowledge of who is the happy person in this earth. So a few things are considered. So depending on what do we all want. So if you look at, if we go and ask anybody, that person, what do you want to be? They will say, hey, I want to be always young. Because like Markandeya, somebody who is always young, nothing wrong with that, right? If nothing wrong in seeking that, hey, let me have a youthfulness always, because I don't want to be aging, because it's a measure of happiness. Suppose you have a choice, anybody has a choice to be you are all the time, the person will choose, because that gives an upadhi, a body which is strong, which more listens to your mind. Therefore being a yuva and being knowledgeable, nobody wants to be ignorant. And then one needs to have all the wealth in the world. One seeks to have power. So all these things. So if all of them come to a person, then that person can be considered, a perfect happy person in this world. And that is taken as one unit of Ananda, as a measure. Okay. This, based on that measure, all other Anandas are kind of told or shown in terms of multiples of this measure, as a way to show how different upadhis can if okay, a person, a jiva can take different upadis, like a manushya upadi. So within the earth itself, one can take a different upadi. There are so many living creatures, from ant to a human body, and you know, from plants to microorganisms and all that. Any number of, there are numerous upadis which are possible. Similarly, beyond this bhūloka, if you assume that there are other lokas, or if we believe with Shraddha in Shastra, there are multiple other lokas which are spoken about, and those upadis are also possible for a jiva to take. And each upadi has its own vishesha or a speciality in terms of the happiness that upadi can provide. A happiness that an ant gets versus what a crow gets versus what a snake gets versus what a cow gets versus what a human body gets obviously has to be different. They can't all be the same. Similarly, the upadis which are there other than in this bhūloka, like a gandharva sharira or you know deva sharira, they should naturally have a difference in the happiness that each one you know gains. It will depend on the kind of senses they have and kind of things that they come in touch with. All those things are going to influence the happiness that each of this upadi is going to have. Now, how does it, what is the scale of difference between these upadis is the analysis. Now let's look at this. Yuva prathama vayaha. So he is a youth. Sadhu yuva iti. And he is also a sadhu, somebody who is not restless. He is at peace. So not just youth, but also youth not restless. Okay, a restless youth is not going to be happy. The youth who is not restless, he who is at peace with oneself, that kind of a youth is going to be a happy person. Sadhuscha asau yuva cha yunaha visheshanam. So there is the yuva is used as an adjective here. Therefore, a restless, non-restless youth. So he, why do you use yuva jati sadhu yuva iti? So why is Upanishad emphasizing on the youth being, the young person being non-restless? Is because yuva api asadhur bhavati, sadhu api ayuva. There is a possibility always of youth, of a young person being restless. Or in some cases, you will find a person who is not restless, but he is well past his youth, he or she. So both possibilities are there. So therefore, ataha visheshanam yuva syat sadhu yuva iti. Therefore, both are used, an young person and a non-restless person. So if that is the person, then that person will have more happiness. And then again, further qualifications, adhyayakaha. Adhita Vedaha, the person who is also well educated, knowledgeable. One is not ignorant, right? So a person may be strong, a person may be youthful, a person may be non-restless, but if the person is ignorant, the person is not knowledgeable, then that person is not going to have the level of happiness that someone who is educated, who is knowledgeable will have, because happiness also comes from, you know, studying literature, listening to music, learning. So the knowledge gives a happiness, right? Vidya sukham. So if somebody is ignorant, that ignorant person is not going to have the same level of happiness. I mean, there should be a certain level of knowledge and awareness. Therefore, he says, adhita vedaha. Veda represents knowledge. Adhyayakaha. Asishtaha, Ashutamaha, the person is alert, he is not procrastinating. So he is a very energetic, dynamic person. Dridishtaha, he is very healthy. Balishtaha, he is very strong. So if that is the person, so these are all personality traits, correct? A person who is strong, who is healthy, and then who is non-procrastinating, alert, and who is knowledgeable, right? That kind of a person with all other external things that that person needs, right? Therefore, he says, evam adhyatmika sadhana sampannaha. So these are all his personality, individual traits. And then, what are the other wealth he possesses? It's listed next. Tasya iyam prithivi urvi sarva vittasya vittena upabhoga sadhanena drishtartena adrishtartha sadhanena cha karma sadhanena sampannaha purna syatu. Suppose this person who is endowed with all these great individual traits, qualities, nature, if this person is also endowed with external things like the wealth, all the wealth that is there in the world, prithivi sarva vittasya, the entire wealth in this earth, suppose, become a possession of this person. Vittasya vittena upabhoga sadhanena drishtartena adrishtartha sadhanena, whatever is known, unknown, everything is under his disposal. Karma sadhanena sampanna purna. If there is such a person, right, who is like endowed with all the wealth, raja prithivi patihi ityartha, like he is, like that person is the king of the entire world, right, rules, you know, the Americas and Australias and all the continents, Europe and Asia, all the wealth is under that person's disposal. If there was to be such a person, tasya cha yaha anandaha sa ekaha manushya manushaha manushyanam prakrishtaha eka anandaha. So now, if that kind of a person who has individual prowess and also all the wealth in the world, the kingdom, the rule over the world, then that person's happiness is going to be a reference point. Correct? Tasya cha anandaha ekaha manushaha manushyanam prakrishtaha ekaha anandaha. That kind of a happiness, okay, then that can be assumed to be one unit of an ideal human, you know, happiness limit. We can take it that way, right? This is the maximum a human can get, right? Because if you are only going to depend on your upadhi, your body, your mind, and the external things that you can get on the earth, an ideal situation is this, right? It can't get better than this. So that's the way a human unit of an ideal happiness is measured. Okay, if that kind of a measure is used, I mean, so think of it, right? You can't measure the ideal happiness beyond what Shastra has shown here, right? I mean, so it has considered three aspects, right? The body, physical body, and its state of body. So gain the ideal body. Second, mind, right? An ideal mind, mental situation, right? So it is like non-restless, it is knowledgeable, all that, right? So it is the inner instruments. The third is outside wealth, right? So it is basically taking that, hey, the best possible physical body, the best possible mental state, and the best possible external wealth, okay? So all the three it is covering. So once all of them are there at its best, then that becomes the ideal limit of a human happiness. So if you take that as one unit, then how does the other upadhis, other bodies which are outside of this bhuloka, how do they measure up to this? I think that's the kind of examination here, right? Now the Shastra goes to say, teye satam manusha anandaha. That kind of a human happiness, if it is multiplied hundredfold, then sayekaha manushya gandharvana manandaha. that 100 times of that kind of an ideal human happiness is what can be gained by another upadhi, which is a manushya gandharva upadhi, a body, an instrument which is of a manushya gandharva. Why? Because gandharva is the one which has an aesthetic excellence in terms of what the gandharvas enjoy, right? So the aesthetics give happiness much more than what what a materialistic enjoyment gives. So that aesthetic element is what differentiates a manushya gandharva from manushya. Okay, in fact, he's going to describe this manushya gandharva also in terms of the nature of their upadhi, which has least resistance. Okay, despite the human body can be, you know, strong and all that, but still there are bodily limitations, right? It is, it can be, there are afflictions which are possible in the human body, right? You can get hurt. You may be the richest person on the earth. If you fall down, your leg still hurts, correct? So the body has its own limitations. You can get a stomach ache, then it's a problem, correct? So, but yeah, the ideal unit of human happiness assumes that none of this is there, but still the manushya gandharva body is the least resistant body. That's what he's going to talk about. So also the gandharva is supposed to be an aesthetic, the upadhi which enjoys nritya gita and all that. So the Vartikakara Sureshwara talks about this in his Vartika about the manushya gandharva sharira. So we have to just understand it as an upadhi which is more, the body itself has more, a better quality sharira than a human sharira, right? Then only that it can have an 100-fold happiness. Because we are not talking about a jnanam and all that here. We are purely talking in terms of the upadhi and the happiness that can come out of that, right? Sayekaha manushya gandharvana manandaha. So the manushya gandharva upadhi has a 100-fold happiness as compared to an ideal human happiness limit. Okay. Manushanandat satagunotkrishtaha manushya gandharvanam anandaha bhavati manushyaha santaha karma vidya viseshat gandharvatvam praptaha manushya gandharvaha. So there are two types of gandharva. One is deva gandharva, the another one is manushya gandharva. Now here, what is this manushya gandharva? Bhashyakara explains, manushya santaha. These are human to start with, but karma vidya viseshati, by doing vaidika karma, meditation, vidya here means dhyana, etc. So this, because of meditation, tapas, these humans gain another upadhi, gandharvatvam praptaha. So the evolution of human into a gandharva because of karma vidya viseshat, by doing penance, by doing vaidika karma and all that, because of that the humans have become gandharva, then that upadhi is manushya gandharva. So there is a, in Bhashikara's time, that kind of possibility was known. Okay, I'm assuming that, you know, it was probably in prevalence there. So that kind of an understanding, or people regarded those kind of things, right? So we don't know, I mean, in this, how, what kind of karma and what kind of vidya is going to give one the manushya gandharvatva sharira and all that. But here the idea is to show that the happiness is based on the upadhi, right? That is the essence. So you are human. See, the whole import of shastra here is not to, you know, motivate people to take different shariras, but to show that the happiness is based on upadhi here, Whereas, you know, that he's going to compare Shrotriyasya Akamahatasya. So the same happiness, which is manifold of human happiness, can be gained by somebody who pursues jnanam. Okay, that is the idea, correct? So, but to as a just to understand this, we have to just go with what Shastra says here, rather than, you know, trying and nitpick, saying, you know, how do we know this kind of is possible? What upasana can be done to become Manishya Gandharva and all that? Because we don't know, right? So, but let's assume that during Bhashikara's time, this was there. So he just mentions it, right? So here, Manushya Santaha, Karma Vidya Visheshati, Gandharvatvam Praptaha, Manushya Gandharvaha. The Manushya Gandharva Shariram, Upadhi, can be gained by human beings by doing certain penance. Those kind of people are called Manushya Gandharva, in opposition to Deva Gandharva, which is another kind of Sharira that we will talk about a little in a bit. Tehi antardhanadi shakti sampannaha sukshma karya karanaha. So their karya karana means upadhi, the instruments of experience, right, and action. So the physical body, mind, etc. Those, that body is antardhanadi shakti sampannaha. They can disappear and reappear at any points. Okay, so like our Star Trek. So then the Devagandhar, the Manishya Gandharva can just can hide themselves because their body is subtle, right? It is not gross. Okay, so they just dematerialize at one point and then reappear at some other point. So those kind of shariras they have. Antardhanadi shakti sampannaha sukshma karya karanaha. So this dematerialization was envisioned in those days, right? That's what it means. Tasmat pratigata alpatvam tesham. So pratigata means obstruction, right? So alpatvam, so they have very little physical obstructions, right? It's because it is subtle, it can move, right? See, for us, you know, our body is grass. Therefore, we have limitations of where we are, how we move, correct? So it can get hurt. So it has its own, irrespective of how much wealth you have, the body pulls you down, correct? Physical body has its own limitation. Whereas if it is a subtle one like a Manushya Gandharva, then those kind of limit, it is just free. It is like wind. Like, you know, imagine, right? Your body is very light, like you are in Shavasana. How you feel, right? So you don't feel the heaviness of the body. You are just, you know, roaming. Like that, if the body is there, so obviously that body has 100 times more happiness than a human body. That's what, that is the idea here. Pratigata alpatvam tesham dvandva pratigata shakti sadhana sampattischa. Okay, so there is this strength, okay, of dvandva pratigata shakti. Okay, so there is unobstructed movements and all that. Tataha apratihanyamanasya pratikaravataha manushya gandharvasya syat chitta prasadaha. Chitta prasada means happiness, mental happiness, right? Joy. Because there is apratihanyamanatvam, unobstructedness, okay, then against all the obstructions, pratikaravataha, manushya gandharvasya syat chitta prasadaha. So that mind has more happiness because it is just roaming freely. It is floating, right? It's not tied down by the physical body's limitations. Tat prasada viseshat sukha visesha abhivyaktihi. Because there is a mental happiness of enjoying taking a flight, then sukha visesha abhivyaktihi, that charira has more happiness. Evam purvasya purvasya bhumehe uttarasyam uttarasyam bhumau prasada viseshataha satagunanandotkarshaha upapadyate. Similarly, purvasya purvasya bhumehe, so of the Purvasya means here the lower bodies, we can say, right? So you have Manishya body, then Manishya Gandharva, then Deva Gandharva, then Ajana Jana Deva, then Deva Sharira. Like that, there are multiple Shariras. So in the later spheres of experience, the earlier spheres of experience is getting multiplied. Prasada Visheshataha, because of the Upadhi and the mind's happiness, there is a hundredfold increase in every subsequent sphere. So the Upadhi Vishesha determines how much happiness that particular jiva experiences in that body. Prathamam tu akamahata agrahanam manushya vishaya bhoga kama anabhihatasya srotriyasya manushyanandat satagunena ānandotkarshah manushya gandharvena tulyah vaktavyah iti evam artham. Okay, the question is this: manushya sayeko manusha anandah then teye satam manusha anandah and then sayeko de manushya gandharvana manandah srotriyasya cha kamahatasya. So after it says hundredfold human happiness is manushya gandharvananda, Shastra adds a line, Shrotriyasya Akamahatasya. The person who has listened, learnt Veda, and who is not afflicted by desire, that is Akamahatam. So that Akamahatatvam is an important trait for a person to gain that happiness. So it is, if you take the Upadhi-centered happiness, it is by fulfillment of desires. Whereas akamahata means absence of desires. So fulfillment of desires cannot happen for all desires because there are infinite desires. There is no limit to human or any upadhi, you know, not just human, right? Any upadhi person, if the person is not a jnani, will have desires. And those desires are not limited. If one is fulfilled, another one comes. So, therefore, this akamahata means the person who is not afflicted by desires. That kind of a person is what is compared. But in this case, so the first time the reference to Shrotriya and akamahata happens only when Manushya Gandharva is spoken about. Not this Manushya Ananda. The person, yuvasyat sadhu yuvadhyayakaha, that ideal human ananda was spoken about. There, the Srotriya Akamahata is not spoken about. Why is that? So, Bhashyakara takes that prathamam to akamahata agrahanam. In the first case of the ideal human happiness is not compared to Srotriya Akamahatatvam. Why is it? He is asking Akamahata Grahanam Manushya Vishaya Bhoga Kama Anabhihatasya Srotriyasya Manushya Anandat Satagunena Anandotkarshaha. So the idea is even within a human existence, this Srotriya and Akamahata's Ananda is 100 times the ananda of an ideal human happiness. So to show that the Srotriya Akamahata ananda, even within this earth, is much more than what best a human body can get. To show that is why it is not equated with the ideal human ananda. Get that point? So ideal human ananda also falls short of what a Shrotriya and Akamahata gets. That is the idea. Okay. Therefore, he says, Manushya Vishaya Bhoga Kama Anabhihatasya Shrotriyasya Manushya Anandat Satagunena Anandotkarshaha Manushya Gandharvena Tulyaha Vaktavyaha Iti Eva Martham. Therefore, the first time the Shrotriyasya Akamahatasya is not used. Only a minimum of 100 times ideal human ananda is there in a Shrotriya and Akamahata. Okay, that is the That is what is meant here. Sadhu yuvadhyayakaha iti shrotriyatva avrijinatve grihyate. Now there is one question. Shrotriyasya chakamahatasya is used not for in the sampradaya doesn't use it for jnani. I think we saw it already in the previous class. So Bhashikara takes it as Shrotriya is not a Brahmajnani, but Shrotriya is somebody who has learnt Vedas. But akamahata means the person relatively is free of desires, less afflicted by desires. Okay. Now, there is a sadhu yuva adhyayakaha is already used even to define an ideal human being. So this ideal human happiness already includes sadhutvam. It already used yuva and it also has already included adhyayakaha. So the person is learned is already said. Now you can't say a learned ideal ananda is a person who is learned and then say 100 times this is the learned, right? So that is a contradiction. Therefore, Bhashikara is clarifying here. Shrotiyatva avrijinatve grihyate. The learnedness and vrijinam means papa. Okay, avrijinatva means with less papa, right? So without papa, that is already taken into consideration. Tehi avisishte sarvatra, that is common everywhere. But what is missing is akamahatatvam, absence of desire, less afflicted by desire. See, that is the most important thing. Akamahatatvam tu vishayotkarsha apakarshataha sukotkarsha apakarshaya viseshyate. The differences in terms of how much desire, absence of desire is there. So that determines the level of happiness. So the only variable there is the akamahatattvam, is what Bhashikara says. The difference between what an upadhi gets in Devagandharva Sharira, Manishyagandharva Sharira, Deva Sharira, all these things is to the extent of absence of desire. Okay, so if there are three, in fact we will conclude this later saying that there are three variables, right? One variable is the learnedness, right? Shrotriyatvam. Then second is avrijinatvam, absence of papa. The third is akamahatatvam, the level of the absence of affliction of desire. And it is the third one which is variable between these upadhis. Like that he is going to say. Ataha akamahata grahanam tad visheshataha sataguna sukotkarsha upalabdehe akamahatatvasya paramananda prapti sadhanatva vidhanartham. So akamahata grahanam, the absence of affliction of desires, is viseshataha, is the essential reason why sataguna sukotkarsha upalabdehe, the hundredfold gain of happiness, akamahatatvasya paramananda prapti sadhanatva vidhanartham. It is the desire, the extent of desireslessness, which is impacting your happiness level. To show that only this is used is what Bhashikara says. So what is the key difference in, so what is the key factor which influences the happiness? It is the level of desire freeness. Okay. Now vyakhyatam anyate. So the other aspects are already explained. What does he mean by that? So only the shariras keep changing because it's same thing repeats itself, right? Teye satam manushya manusha anandaha sayeko manushya gandharvana manandaha teye satam manushya gandharvana manandaha anandaha sayekaha deva gandharvana manandaha teye satam deva gandharvana. Like that it goes, right? 100 times this is the next one, 100 times that is the next one. It keeps telling the same thing. So Bhashikara is saying, I mean, understand all of them in the same way. So So the only thing he is going to explain is what are these different upadis. Okay, what does Devagandharva mean? What is Ajanajanam Devana means? Like that he is going to show, just explain those. But the idea, the basic idea, the core idea is 100 times each of the upadis Ananda is the next upadis Ananda. Okay. And that is equivalent to a learned person within that upadi. Okay. Let's see. Devagandharvaha jatitaha eva. So this Devagandharva is a collection, a group of Gandharvas within Devas. Like within Manushya, you had certain people who are Manushya Gandharvas because they attain those bodies through penance. Like that, amongst Devas also, there are Gandharva bodies. Okay. So that is a Deva Gandharva. So they have 100 times more happiness than Manushya Gandharva. Okay, then Teye Shatam Chiraloka Lokanam Anandaha. That is the next one. What is this Chiraloka Loka? He says Chiraloka Lokanam iti Pitrunam Visheshanam. The Pitru means the human. Once they have left the body and because of all the pindodaka kriya of their sons, right? So the progenies, they have to do certain udaka kriya, pindakriya and all that. So those help the person gain pitriloka, is what shastra say, right? This pitriloka means it's a kind of an upadhi one takes in a particular loka, and with, so there is a special type of pitriloka which is chiraloka loka. Therefore it's a pitrinam visheshanam is chiraloka. Chiraloka loka nam iti pitrinam visheshanam. And this loka is slightly, it's one category of pitriloka because see next line says that chirakalastayi lokaha yesham pitrinam te chiraloka lokaha iti. Chirakalastayi lokaha. This loka is a longer duration pitriloka. Okay. So there are some, so we have to just, what do you say? We have to understand it the way it is, because there is no other pramana for these things, right? Shastra is the only pramana. So there is no pass, there is no, what do you say? There is no reason or there is no way to either prove it or disprove it either, right? So nothing stops the possibility of such a loka, right? And so therefore, just like a human existence, a life is here. I mean, we can always, there could always be another loka where these pitras can be, right? So because we, there's nothing to disprove something like this. So we have to just understand how it is presented here. So here what he says, chirakalastayi lokaha yesham pitrinam te chiraloka lokaha. So the chirakalastayi, this the duration of the life in this loka is long. Chirakalastayi, it is stable and it is long. That kind of a loka is pitrinam, where the pitris stay for a long time, is called chiraloka loka. So that is more happiness than the Devagandharva happiness. Okay. So that is 100 times of Devaloka happiness. Then you have Ajana Janam Devanam. Ajana iti Devaloka. The Devaloka is called Ajana, Ajana Loka. Okay. Tasmin Ajane Jataha Ajana Ja Devaha. The Devas who are born Ajane Jataha, that way, born in the Devaloka are called Ajana Ja Deva. And he says, how does one gain that loka? Smartha karma visheshataha devasthanesha jataha. So there are certain smartha karma, smriti prescribed karmas. Okay, so a human performing this smartha karmas, seeking this devasthana, okay, once that karma fructifies, the person gains this devaloka, this ajana janam devanam anandaha. The Ajana Jaloka, the one, the Ajana Loka. Okay, the Devas will be born in that Ajana Loka, and they gain 100 times more happiness than Chiraloka Loka. Okay, so we just have to understand. So basically, the idea is there are different kind of shariras which are possible, different lokas which are possible, and there is a gradation in terms of happiness one can gain. Okay, that is what it is. Then this next loka is karma devaha ye vaidikena karmana agnihotradina kevalena devan apiyanti devaha iti trayam tayastrimshat avirbhujaha. Okay, there is a karma devanam devanam anandaha and then devanam anandaha. What are these karma deva? Vaidikena karmana agnihotradina kevalena. Okay, by doing certain vaidika shruti chodita karma like agnihotra and all that, one can gain this particular body called karma deva body. The deva who are born because of karma, right? That's what it is. Then there is a deva sharira. What are these deva? Trayastrimshat havirbhujaha. The 33 devas, devatas like Agni, Soma, Pavamana, you know, Surya, all these. There are 33 devatas which are spoken about in Veda. And these 33 devas who are havirbhujaha, who are grow because of this havis. Okay, havi is the offering you make in the fire, is taken and that gives strength to these devas. That is the shastric view, right? So Agni Pavamana Agneya Danna Mama, like that, the person does a homa, then that havis gives strength to these devas. So therefore they are called as havirbhujaha. They eat the havis, the strength from this offering. They are called devas. Trayastrimshat havirbhujaha. So that deva ananda is 100 times karma devas ananda. Okay, then Indraha Tesham Swami. So the 100 times their ananda is Indra's ananda. Indra is singular, like Indrasya. So far we were saying Devanam, Karma Devanam, like that, plural. So from here onwards it's going to be singular because there are not multiple Indras. There is only one Indra. Indraha Tesham Swami. So 100 times Deva's ananda is Indrasya ananda. Obviously the ruler has more happiness because the person has more control and freedom and all that, right? So therefore Indra has hundredfold happiness than these devas. From here onwards there are no 100 Indras, 100 Brihaspatis, 100 Prajapati and all that. But even then hundredfold is spoken just multiplying the happiness itself. Okay, so therefore Indra tasya acharyaha Brihaspatihi. So Brihaspati has 100 times Indra's happiness because Brihaspati is the acharya of Indra. The teacher has, because Indra also prostrates before his acharya, right? So this Brihaspati is more happy than Indra. And that's what it says. Tasya acharyaha Brihaspati. Then Prajapatihi Virat Trailokya Shariraha. So more than Brihaspati's ananda, see, in fact, Indra also is seen as a jnani only. Okay, in Keno Upanishad, Indra learns this Brahma Vidya from Uma, Parvati, right? Like that, the story is there. So here we are not talking about the jnanam related happiness, right? It is only the upadhi related. So we have to just understand the context. Otherwise, we will reduce Indra also like a human. That is not the idea here. But the idea is to show that different upadhis have different gradation of ananda. So Brihaspati. Then Prajapatihi, who is Prajapati? Virat, Trailokya Shariraha, the Bhurbhuvasvaha iti. There are three lokas are there. And all the three together is by one Sharira, which is called Virat. Okay. That is that like a Brahma. Prajapati is actually Brahmaji. We call it as Virat. Brahma also, Virat, Hiranyagarbha, like that, different depending on whether you are talking about the Sukshma Samashti or Stula Samashti, right? So here Virat is Stulatvam. So these three, the gross aspect of the collective, that is Samashti, right, is called Virat. That Sharira is there for Prajapati. That Prajapati has 100 times happiness like Brihaspati. And then finally comes Brahma. So Padseya Shadam Prajapate Ranandaha Sayeko Brahmana Anandaha. Brahma is Hiranyagarbha. Hiranyagarbha is the subtler collective, Samashti Vyashti Rupaha, Samsara Mandala Vyapi. This upadhi is samashti vishti rupa, both the collective and individual, the subtle aspect, right? The subtle is collective, so, and it is all connected, no? So sometimes we can, when somebody thinks of us, we also think of them. How is it possible? So many times that happens because there is a collective. The subtle things are connected. Samashti vyashti rupaha samsara mandala vyapi. So that is, that kind of a sharira is for Brahma. It's called Hiranyagarbha. So that is hundredfold virat. There is, see, the subtle is always, you know, more happy and more, it's manifold, sought upadhi than a gross one, correct? A gross always has its limitation. Subtle is more free. Therefore, Virat and Hiranyagarbha are almost same. The only difference is Virat is gross, Hiranyagarbha is subtle. Right, Hiranyagarbha means it is inside in a golden form. Right, that's what it means. Brahma, samashti vishti rupaha, samsara mandala vyapi, yatra yete ananda bedaha, ekatam gacchanti, dharmascha tannimittaha, jnanam cha tadvishayam, akamahatattvam cha niratishayam yatra, saha yeshaha, Hiranyagarbha Brahma. He further explains this Hiranyagarbha Sharira, Ananda Bedaha Ekatam Gacchanti, all the differences of Ananda in, because now we are talking collective, right? When you say collective, it includes human Sharira, it includes Manushya Gandharva Sharira, Deva Gandharva Sharira, Ajana Janam Devanam Sharira, Karma Deva Sharira, everything is included in it, right? Indra Sharira, Prajapati Sharira, Bhaspati Sharira, everything is included because it is collective, right? It is samashti. Therefore, Bhashyakara says, Ananda Bedaha Ekatam Gacchanti, it unifies. All the happiness is all unified in this one Sharira. Dharmascha Tannimittaha Jnanam Tatadvishayam, all this knowledge of everything that is there, all the Punya Papa, everything is unified in this one samashti. Akamahatattvam cha niratishayam yatra. Even the desirelessness also is in a exalted state. Therefore, that is, that kind of a sharira is Hiranyagarbha Brahma. It is one of the best possible, right? It is a samashti and all that in beyond human and every kind of, it includes all kinds of shariras in it, right? And is subtler. Tasya yeshaha anandaha shrotriyena avrijinena akamahatena cha sarvataha pratyaksham upalabhyate. In each of this upadhi, the shrotriya and akamahata has the ananda which is equivalent to a Hiranyagarbha ananda. Okay, shrotriya means a person who is learned, avrijinaha means who is without papa, akamahata means who is devoid of desires. So, in fact, the sampradaya takes that depending on how much desirelessness is there, so much is your increase in happiness. Tasmat yetani trini sadhanani iti avagamyate. Therefore, we understand that these three are sadhanas. Three things have to be practiced. What are the three? Shrotriyatvam, avrijinatvam, akamahatattvam. So learn Veda Vedanta if you want to be happy. Be avrijinaha. Don't accumulate papa and be akamahata. So work on reducing desire. Jnanam is a different thing. So here desirelessness in a relative sense. So these three have to be sadhanas. Yetani trini sadhanani iti avagamyate. So you have to understand that these three are important. That is the essence of this whole Mimamsa, right? So why is it, how does it matter how much happiness Ajana Janan Devanam is going to get for us? It's not that, okay, the Shastra is not asking you to go on an Ananda trip, right? like, you know, try to do some penance and become karma deva. Like, that is not the focus. If that was the focus, it would have spoken about that. But it never spoke about these things, right? Only in this context it is talking. Therefore, the intent of Shastra is not to push you to gain different upadhi, but it is trying to show that these three things are important for you to be happy. One is Shrotriyatvam, second is Avrijinatvam, third is Akamahatatvam. Therefore, etani trini sadhanani, these three are the sadhanas. Tatra, Shrotriyatva Avrijinatve niyate, Akamahatatvam tu utkrishyate iti Pratrishta sadhanata avagamyate. Amongst these three, Shrotriyatvam and Avrijinatvam is there everywhere in all the upadis. But what is varying is Akamahatatvam only. Because everywhere Shrotriya is a Shrotriya, right? And there is no difference, right? You can't say it's a more Shrotriya and this is less Shrotriya. That is not the intent here. And Avrijinatvam also is there. But what is the difference? Akamahatattvam only is different. So if you are little more Akamahata, then you get the Devagandharva happiness. If you are more Akamahata, you get Karma Deva, Ajana Janam Devanam happiness, like that. So the you keep on reducing your desire, the more and more you will be happy. Iti avagamyate is what we understand from this. Then sayaschayam purushe yascha savaditye sayekaha. So now it is taking it to the next level. What is it saying? Whatever is there in this purusha is the same is there in the Surya Mandala as the Aditya. Sa ekaha, the both are same. The happiness and the experience of a Deva who is Aditya, same as this Purusha. Tasya akama hatattva prakarshataha cha upalabhyamanaha shrotriya pratyakshaha brahmanaha anandaha yasya paramanandasya matra ekadeshaha etasya vanandasya anyani bhutani matram upajivanti iti shrutyantarati sayesha anandaha yasya matraha samudrambasaha iva viprushaha pravibhaktaha yatra ekatam gataha sayesha paramanandaha swabhavikaha advaitatvat anandanandinaha cha avibhagaha atra. So we'll see in the next class, but I wanted to just summarize this because it kind of brings it all together, right? So what is this ananda? This ananda is paramanandasya matra. This ananda, all this gradation, is still only part of the paramananda. Etasyeva anandasya anyani bhutani matram upajivanti. This ananda, which is the Brahma Svarūpa, which is limitless ananda. Of this limitless ananda, a limited portion is what all the life forms are enjoying. Matram upajivanti. There is a Brihadaranyaka vakyam. Iti shrutyantarati paramanandasya matra ekadeshaha. So there is just a part of it is being enjoyed. Because there is no limit, unlimited ananta swarupam, ananda swarupam. It's not an experiential ananda. Experiential ananda comes and goes and it is limited. And that is based on your upadhi. Because experiential ananda is limited by your instrument. Whatever your mind and body can enjoy is what it can enjoy. Right? But Svarupa Ananda has no limitation because it's not constrained by your upadhi. So irrespective of what kind of upadhi you get, however exalted it may be, it has to have its own limitation if it is based on the upadhi. Whereas if it is Svarupa Ananda, it is unhindered. Therefore, this matra meva upajivanti. So all these, only to the extent you are freed from desire, only to the extent you are devoid of papa, you can enjoy in an upadhi. Whereas, If there is no upadhi, there is no dependence on anything external, your Svarūpa itself is an Ananda Svarūpa, then there is no limit. That's why Shastra says, Etasya eva anandasya anyani bhutani matram upajivanti. Only a portion is experienced. Therefore, you become Shrotriya, Avrijina and Akamahata. You try to pursue that. Is what the Shastra is trying to tell us. Okay, so we'll see in the next class. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamadachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Avasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.
धन्यवाद
धन्यवाद गुरुजी.
Yeah.